It's a rare honor for the India Rivers Week. That second time in the running, it has a person like Sri Jairam Ramesh ji. To give us his ashirwad, and his very presence. You see, what is Sri Jairam Ramesh ji, as we understand, if I could use that term, maybe the only, or let me be more liberal, few thinking parliamentarians in this country. And long before remaining online and Twitter and all that became so popular, it was Sri Jairam Ramesh ji who was always available, just on a click of the button. You see, for this and for the last also, I must make this. And it's a matter of great privilege for me that a single SMS from such a low person like me, what am I in front of Sri Jairam Ramesh ji, but a SMS from me elicits immediate response. If he is available, he is available. If he is not available, he is not available. So I wish parliamentarians in this country were like this. We talk of transparency and we talk of quick response. It cannot be a greater quick response from just like this. We are really grateful to you, sir, for all this. For this session, may I request Shri Ravi Agarwal ji to please come on the dais, Manu Bhatnagar ji to please, Professor Brij Gopal ji, who is an institution in himself, and of course, Shri Jairam Ramesh ji, please.
Good evening, everybody. We now come to the river talk, the second in the series. As you know, last year we had Anupam Mishra ji deliver a talk on one aspect and state of the Indian rivers. And this time we have another very eminent speaker, Dr. Brij Gopal, whom I'll introduce to you shortly. Of course, he requires no introduction. He's been part of the, the river landscape for a very long time. But it is an honor for us to welcome both him and Sri Jairam Ramesh, who's going to chair the session for this talk. Sri Jairam Ramesh, of course, requires no introduction, but he has been introduced just before I started speaking by Manoj Mishra ji, and I don't think I can top that introduction. But as you know, he's an economist by profession and has been a member of the Rajya Sabha Member of Parliament since 2004, and has had several ministerial capacity positions in the Government of India for a very long time, including the Ministry of Environment and Forest, Drinking Water and Sanitation, Rural Development, etc. But on a more or less formal note, as Manoj said, he's been one of the rational voices in the environmental debate for some time now. I'd like to introduce to you Dr. Brij Gopal, who's currently coordinator, Center for Inland Waters in South Asia. He's an aquatic ecologist by training. He earned his PhD in plant ecology from Banaras Hindu University. He's retired as professor of environmental science at the JNU in 2009. He had served at the Agra College and Rajasthan University, and was also a visiting professor at the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology, Zurich, in 1984. He's the only recipient of the Nauman Tiananmen Medal 2004 of the International Association of Limnology outside Europe and North America, and only the second Asian recipient of the International Fellow Award of the Society for Wetland Scientists. He serves on several committees of the Government of India and has been a long-standing proponent of the River Regulation Zone. And very importantly, he's currently been the person who's presented many science-based arguments against the now well-known Ken Betwa link proposal. And as we all know, he is often consulted by the National Green Tribunal in advisory capacity for his views on several matters. Dr. Brij Gopal will be speaking today on river health, diagnostics and treatment. I give to you Dr. Brij Gopal, sir.
Shri Ravi Agrawal ji, Manohar Mishra ji, Sajal Bora, esteemed participants to this India River Week workshop or conference. It is a rare privilege, great honor done by the organizers of the India River Week to ask me to deliver the second river lecture here before you. I won't be too humble in saying that I know very little, but my interaction with the rivers and the studies understanding directly has been only about 30 years since I came to Delhi and started looking Yamuna and its tributaries. I did survey the entire stretch up to Harkidoon and beyond, and practically would have measured, if not every meter, every 100 meters by tape all along this stretch. So I know the river Yamuna at least, though my studies as a student I had been in Kanpur where I used to visit Ganga almost every day, and then in Banaras where I experienced Ganga for 8 years. So I know the rivers, at least in the Ganga system, a bit. And after retirement, as Ravi Agrawalji did mention, so I should point out, I just thought that if the government of India is so lukewarm to the interest of the rivers and the aquatic systems as such, that despite their own resolution and a recommendation to the Planning Commission, they failed to set up an institute for aquatic ecosystem studies, I thought that I will invest all my earnings, savings, somewhere where I can study water, and it took me unknowingly, unplanned, to Khajuraho. And I said, well, there are several thousand tanks at least 10 to 12 centuries old, which supported this Bundelkhand area, and I have surveyed several districts. Then several rivers, not just Ken and Betwa and Yamuna and Ganga, are only within walking distance of 200 kilometers. So I said, here we can try to do something. Lo and behold, I tried to survey at least two-thirds of the river Ken myself again. And there are things which no one ever in the Ministry of Water Resources and all those very engineers who talk of using rivers have ever looked at. That is something which I have tried to report. Manoj Mishra ji has seen those beautiful geological formations and structures which are unique in India will get destroyed, buried under the project if it comes through. So I have raised my feelings that there are things which need to be investigated first. The rivers have to be understood first. So without going time, I was asked to talk because this is the India River Week, which is going to focus on the state of India's rivers, river health, and people here have tried to develop a report card on state of rivers or rivers health in the country. So it is naturally pertinent that I talk about the river health. And after discussion with the organizers, I thought, well, I would put it short, how to diagnose the health using the same medical terminology, and can we treat the river if it were to be. So that's what my title is. Let me say a few words for health, which are very relevant when we try to use this metaphor to the rivers or any other natural ecosystem. WHO had defined health in their 1946 preamble as the state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease or infection. But after 40 years, they have modified it, and that modification, let me read it out, the extent to which an individual or group is able to realize aspirations and satisfy needs and to change or cope with the environment. Health is a resource for everyday life and not the object of living. This is very important. It's a resource so that the human can do something. That's doing. It is a positive concept emphasizing social and personal resources as well as physical capacities. Thus, health refers to the ability to handle stress, to acquire skills, maintain relationships, all of which form resources for resilience and independent living. In terms of the human beings, the term conveys, and this can be or has been used only partly in case of the animals also, because there are some difficulties there. The second part of the word in this is the river, and I wonder whether we do understand river. In this morning sessions also the question was raised whether we are able to define the river. Umji also mentioned what's a river, perhaps we don't know. I have my own little way of saying the common perception among the policy makers, those who manage the rivers or who control the rivers, is it is a channel to carry runoff, and therefore you can dam it and divert the water at will. It is a drain to carry waste, and therefore you can dispose all kinds of wastes, liquid or solid, into it. It will take that. A waterway to transport goods, so you can transport coal, ore, people, anything, so make it a navigation channel. It is a stretch of land underwater, so reclaim it and bring it to urbanization. I have been told, sir, personally, that India is very short of land while our population is too large, and therefore there is no option but to use the land along the rivers for all developmental activities. And that is where I really feel that the understanding of what the land along the river margin does is totally forgotten. And that is the problem. A scientific view is a life support system and habitat for 20% of all the life on the earth. That is what is known to the science, and is a published data. But who cares for the organisms? If it carries 20%, let them go away. And for the common man on the street, a believer or otherwise, it's a mother, it's a goddess. Should we continue to be believers, beliefs? And why should we do that? It's no more when the economics takes over and you can make monetary benefits from it. What's a river in science? It's a linear body of naturally flowing, free-flowing water. Rivers start as trickles of surface runoff or from glacial lakes or from subsurface springs. They always grow larger until discharge into another larger body of water that could be a river or a lake or an ocean. They will never go smaller, they will go increasing in size as they join. The small rivers usually merge together as they move downstream, and larger rivers do split to form deltas when they go, and these splitted river channels may have interconnections. The classification of rivers we talked even this morning, there may be ephemeral rivers. Sometimes they flow, sometimes they remain dry channels. Because of our climate is such, there may be seasonal rivers flowing only during the monsoon season or a few months of the year, or they may be perennial rivers. And most of the Indian rivers originating in the Himalayas are naturally perennial with large variability of the flow, while most of the rivers in the peninsular India are more or less seasonal. The ephemeral rivers we have more or less in the dry arid zone. The question is, does a large river have an identity without its tributaries? Again, today we were discussing the tributaries and tributaries as a system in its own right, and we were talking about a tributary which is 150 kilometer, 200 kilometer or so, and then we can take it as a part of the river and take it as an independent thing. But I think it is perhaps a question to be answered. I will show something. Can a small stretch of a river be considered as a river itself? And the next two figures. Here is the Ganga Basin. And these colors show all the tributaries and their subdivisions. Basins, sub-basins, sub-sub-sub-basins. Can I name any of them? In the morning, the case was presented for Betwa Basin. Can Betwa Basin represent Ganga? Can we say it is Ganga? If I know everything about Betwa, it becomes Ganga. Or if Betwa is gone, can the Ganga remain Ganga? So the tributary has a significance for Ganga, but is it a part of Ganga or not needs to be thought of, discussed. And when they divide in the deltas, splitting, the same Ganga, only say the Indian part, there are a large number of rivers which are named separately, Muri Ganga, Saptamukhi, Thakuran, Matla, all these rivers which have been named, are they Ganga? Or they are Ganga's daughters or Ganga's children? Everyone is given a different name, but can Ganga exist without these distributaries, and which of them is Ganga? We were also discussing today also, sir, the question of river science. And because I was also given an idea that I should talk a little about the background global view of the river science. Humans have been interested in the rivers. They have interacted with them for several thousand years. It is not now. The civilizations grew maybe 10,000 years, 50,000 years ago along the rivers and the floodplains. But the role of the rivers in shaping the Earth's surface, this geomorphological change, was recognized only during the 20th century. Before that, neither in European literature nor American literature or anywhere I could find a reference which says that the rivers are responsible for landscaping, the morphology, the fluvial morphology or so. The foundations of ecology of rivers was laid only in 1960s. And very few, perhaps even India, know that an Indian, a product of Delhi University's Zoology Department in 1959, Dr. N.K. Kaushik, is credited globally with initiating the science of the rivers when he first demonstrated how the leaves falling from the forest into the river start the entire food chain, the entire chemistry and the entire life cycle that operates in the river. Before that, there were none. And Hines and Koshik is a paper which had been, when the impact factor was not known, cited more than 10,000 times. There is no paper which would have been cited like that. He got Science Citation Index, highest citation award thrice before the impact factor of other journals became necessary. And we don't know that we were responsible for initiating the river science. Then this initial study of 1960s and the book that his professor wrote in 1970 on the river ecology gave rise to the continuum concept. And that continuum concept credits again Hines and Koshik for the initial studies. That was a view of the river as a unidirectional system. Then came the flood pulse concept, and I am again honored that I had the privilege of working very closely and friendly even today with Dr. Wolfgang Jung of Germany, who worked on Amazon River, where he demolished the continuum concept completely by saying the concept developed from the minor tiny rivers of temperate regions cannot tell us anything about the ecology of the landscape or of the river or their biodiversity. And he developed the flood pulse concept because the Amazon also swells and subsides. At Manaus, it is 18 meters rise and the tree comes underwater and still survives. Then there was a connectivity concept given by Americans, Austrians there, and discontinuity concept, and there are several other concepts. But the influence of the river vertically in the below ground region and the biodiversity there, the hyporic zone, as we say, under the river zone, was only shown in 1988. Until then, it was all river. And portions of the river were being investigated. So there were no, it was still a phase of development of river science for 30 years. We were still trying to understand what a river is. And then people started talking in the landscape. Landscape ecology came up also in 70s, but then they started in the first paper came in 93, which says riparian landscapes, riverine landscapes, that how the patchiness of the landscape can also be interpreted in terms of a river's view. And it happened to be that one of the first PhD students here at JNU, we wrote a paper on Yamuna. It was a rather review literature, and we used the word river escape for the first time ever. He said, this should be called as a river escape and not as a land escape. And then this was followed up with elaboration in 98. That is how it grew. In India, fisheries were documented by the British long back at the end of the 19th century, early 20th century, and so on. Some biological studies were also made before independence, but there were very few and mainly fisheries. The impacts of dams were highlighted by Sir Sundarlal Hora. In his 1936 papers, he raised his voice, a paper published in Current Science, that these dams are affecting the migration of the fishes and should not be allowed. But no one did pay attention to. And he repeated in 1940-41, and still nothing happened at that time. When I happened to be in Banaras, I learned that there had been studies going on before me there on River Ganga. And I got a little understanding of what is the biology of Ganga and what the chemistry of Ganga is at that time in 60s, but the studies had been made in 54-55. Now this professor came later and headed the algal laboratory at the IERI in Delhi. again another class fellow of Kaushik, one Hakumat Rao who migrated to Germany, and perhaps I have survived in Europe because of him. I would say he studied River Yamuna from Palla to Okhla. In 1959, when Wazirabad Barrage had not been constructed, then he had got his PhD. And those papers, even the CPCB initially did not care to refer to, that the entire biodiversity, and I say that is the reference when Wazirabad Barrage was not there, only Okhla Barrage was there. What the biodiversity in the flows and water quality used to be should be a reference for us to know how the river has changed. And post 74, after the Water Pollution Act, of course, there were many more studies, and I have commented upon this. I don't know whether people like it or not. Like many other countries, India has also followed a policy-driven science. Science has perhaps never driven the policy in this country. And so, once the Pollution Control Act comes into play and a Ganga Action Plan is put, 34 projects are funded to all the universities along the Ganga, and everyone is doing mainly water quality and plankton analysis and nothing more. And when Dr. Pat, you'll remember, he was ITRC director, was asked to synthesize, he told me, I'm not getting all the 34 volumes of the reports. The ministry doesn't have those copies of the reports. How do I synthesize? So how the ministry took care of those projects, funded them, we don't have a record of exactly what was published and what was done during that period. And that is documented in the publication on River Ganga, published by the Ministry of Environment. That is again the status. So we have lost a lot of information. Now let me come to the river health. Can I get some water? Term health was used for natural ecosystems first by Aldo Leopold for land, not for natural ecosystems, but this was then transferred by people to natural ecosystems, and the same concept people started saying ecosystem health. The river health, the same concept then from ecosystem health to river health, started getting debated in 95. And there was a special issue where several people put their own comments. Actually, the journal that was started by Professor Rapport, he had come to India and delivered a couple of lectures. He is the founder of Journal on Ecosystem Health, had to close it down because the concept did not move further as he wanted, perhaps. There were some problems with that. Anyway, and stream health, as an analogy and metaphor, provides inspiration and insight according to some, and for others it is not. There are a lot of debate on this. One, Professor Bolton says, the analogy between human health and ecosystem health oversimplifies a very complex issue. Ecosystems are not organisms, do not behave like organisms, and do not have properties of organisms such as health. It leads decision makers in the wrong direction, and that a metaphor like health is not an observable property. I have my own reservations about using the word health, which means that we are treating river as an organism. No other object, whether natural or man-made, has an indefinite life cycle. We all organisms have a definite life span. So there is a growth phase, there is a phase of senescence and death. We talk of a life cycle of many human industrial products these days. For every chemical, what is the life cycle? Industrial life cycle. There is no life cycle for the river alone. In case of ponds and lakes, people have talked about they are getting filled up in a natural process, even if it is 1,000 years, and then getting through a successional phase into a terrestrial system, perhaps. It takes a long time, but no river has ever got a successional phase where it will die out a natural death, not a natural death. So there is a difficulty in understanding. There are several popular views again on river health. I will pass through quickly, but the health, people say it implies a flourishing condition, well-being and so on, vitality, prosperity, and organism is healthy when it performs all its vital functions normally and properly. A healthy organism is resilient. Those are just characteristic what we mean by health. No single indicator can reveal the health of a river. Perhaps that is also true for the humans. If I go to the doctor, whether the platelet count in the blood or the hemoglobin or the RBC count alone will be sufficient to tell my health. Three parameters on the blood. Can the blood sugar or the blood pressure is enough to indicate the health? I think the days are gone when our traditional Vaidya used to read the pulse and still diagnose the health conditions. Now we undergo several hundred tests over a long period before we know what the disease is. And that's the problem when we are looking at a complex system like a river. How can we imagine that one parameter or few parameters can tell us about the state of the river? I will come again still something. So, Mayer says, a healthy stream is an ecosystem that is sustainable and resilient, maintaining its ecological structure and function over time while continuing to meet social needs and expectations. So people have tried to interject also the society and human interactions and their concerns gradually. And there have been two other words we also use even in the bureaucratic circles and government circles reports everywhere now. I use it very often. Biological integrity and ecological integrity. I've been saying there has to be an ecological integrity of the river. What this means, but one Professor Carr from US has distinguished between the biological integrity and ecological integrity. Biological integrity takes into account only the biota and their interactions and functions. The ecological integrity will take into account many more factors, the around environmental factors around that community, and not just. So it says ecological integrity is the sum of physical, chemical, and biological integrity. Now, so there is this growing view with the ecology and integration of the ecological integrity with the human values and things, and gradually it has come that the concept of ecosystem services, which was only 10 years old from the 2005 Millennium Ecosystem Assessment Report, that has also been now put into the river health. It's fine that a healthy river is one which can deliver a variety of ecosystem services. But the difficulty in using all these societal concerns, societal perceptions, and the ecological integrity is that the society's preferences change. And they change with time, they change in different parts of the river basin. What the society in Uttarakhand expects from the Ganga will be very, very different from what the people in West Bengal would expect from Ganga. If it is the same river and the expectations of the ecosystem services being provided by this river, how the river acts, what is the ecological integrity of the river in that stretch is very different from what the river is in the upper stretches. And the still greater problem in using the concept of health is we always have, in case of medical parlance, a standard, a reference point. The BP, if it increases beyond such and such systolic, diastolic levels, this is bad for you. Goes below, it is bad. If your hemoglobin rises from this falls down, it is bad. Pulse rate should be so much. Everything has been defined that this is the standard reference, and any deviation from this will be considered as a indicator of poor health. But in case of liver, to set a reference state, what is very, very difficult. I just mentioned that maybe if we like, if the society likes, the 1960 state of river Yamuna, because we have some data there available, maybe it is not still that complete, could be taken as a reference state. But do we agree on that? The society may say, no, that state cannot be, because then the Wazirabad barrage did not exist, the Indraprastha barrage was not there, and now the river is changed completely. So there are many problems of that. This is a very recent report published by ODI, the Britishers, in 2016 only. I think it's only a couple of months old, where the title itself is How Do Healthy Rivers Benefit Society? And they link with the drivers and pressures right into the river health. And then the river health, there are parameters listed there, number of them, both physical, chemical, biological, and others, and connectivity, and so on, that go into the ecosystem services. Different kind of ecosystem services related to these parameters of river health, and then finally it goes into the different kind of strategic securities. So the linkages between the river health, which is modified by the pressures and drivers, and how the society can benefit both strategically and individual ecosystem services, has been conceptually drawn. This still needs to be looked at perhaps in greater detail. Now I come to the main thing, the diagnostics. In doing so, I forget that whether the health is a acceptable concept or not. I accept it. Let us continue to compare with the health. The same methodology of diagnostics could be used. Let us see what has been done so far. People have been interested. I said river ecology itself came in existence, started in 1960s. Before that, even the water quality assessments were very, very rare. People were talking of any water quality issue, even in US or Europe. Very rare. But assessments were based mostly on water chemistry. Different kind of nutrient, pH, DO, BOD, COD, and different kind of element. They kept on adding them. This started with public health people also analyzing water, waterborne diseases, and the chemistry from that. The only biological parameter that was added directly was the coliforms, because it affected the human health. Now, other parameters I have listed, from salinity and hardness, we used to refer the water, whether it is from a lake, pond, or a well, that it could be hard water, soft water, or so on. The conductivity, which is a measure of the nutrients, the measure of organic matter in terms of the BOD, the odor, which could be due to the anoxic decomposition and the gases coming out. The nutrients, which is mainly nitrogen, phosphorus, there has been a lot of literature on that. And then coming into the geogenic pollutants and heavy metals and new man-made organic substances have come into play. We started in 1974 this exercise. Our CPCB came up with the classification of rivers with five classes A, B, C, D, E. After 40 years, we continue to use. We have not moved beyond that. So that means still the BOD, which is being reported, is good enough to indicate the river. And people have discussed today that BOD doesn't figure anywhere in the whole water quality assessment. That is the state. The chemical parameters are not enough, we have realized, because they miss many human-induced perturbations, like flow alterations. Very interestingly, and that is true for myself, my own studies, when we go and measure the water quality and take a sample, no one has ever reported and doesn't report even today what is the water depth at the time of sample taking, whether it's a lake or a pond, whether the river was flowing or stagnant. We don't get any idea of even a rough estimate of the flow. So there is no relationship with that. Habitat degradation, what kind of habitat where the sample was there, what kind of soil was there, what kind of catchment was there, is never mentioned. We took a sample a little away from the shoreline and analyzed it by standard methods, and the water quality was there. You can see the water quality is bad. There is no need to waste a lot of chemicals and put them back into the water and the soil. That is the kind of situation. Heated effluents, the thermal power plants or otherwise, heated water goes, that has no effect, is never reflected in the water quality. And riparian changes, whether it is the lake shoreline changes or the river riparian changes, they don't get easily reflected in the river analysis, and the kind of the sampling protocol that has been developed for river analysis will never tell anything about whether the riparian vegetation existed or not, and whether it influenced or could influence the water chemistry or not. So biological assessments started, and these started again in a lake in Germany. That is earliest paper in 1925, when Thienemann, German scientist, said the chironomids larvae feeding on the organic matter do indicate the water quality, because any kind of organic matter from the forest or otherwise getting deposited at the lake bottom was promoting the growth of chironomids, which survive in extreme anaerobic conditions. And therefore, that anoxia was reflected in the presence of chironomids. At the same time, all over Europe, this organic matter pollution from the sewage had been a problem, and indices were developed practically in all the countries before the Second World War, the Eastern Europe, Western Europe, in Czech Republic, in Slovak Republic were the dominant groups, and they have listed each and every available organism in water which is a microbe, and identified its level of tolerance to organic matter. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 index is available. If you can identify each and every organism, you can get a very accurate index of how many and which organisms survive. That is a saprobity index, a huge volume where all these few thousand organisms are listed. This is so elaborate. Then came biotic indices based on a variety of organisms. Now we go move away from this, and all this time the emphasis was on two parameters, two things to be known in the water. One was the organic matter and the organisms which can feed on organic matter or can live under suboptimal conditions of oxygen, or the nutrients. So there was a whole program supported by OECD in Canada, in Europe, on eutrophication. And a huge literature exists on eutrophication, which gave us the understanding that phosphorus is the limiting factor and nitrogen availability is not a limiting factor, and because of the phosphorus from the detergents and getting into the water or from the organic matter are the cause of algal blooms and water degradation and whatnot. That was. But then people started following up on Thienemann's work and examining the invertebrates, because insects are the largest group of organisms with maximum diversity. And of these 14 orders of insects, as taxonomists say, 11 breed in water, in shallow water. So there is an enormous diversity of organisms from the group of Insecta and other arthropods, which are dependent upon the aquatic habitat, and they do indicate the water quality in terms of organic matter very, very accurately. And these indices have been developed. And then, of course, we took up the fish. I will come to that. And other organisms came into picture. This is so elaborate. We call them macroinvertebrates or benthos or benthic macroinvertebrates, because they can be seen with the naked eye and can be sampled easily from the mud, that many countries in Europe, even in US, Australia, South Africa particularly, have developed charts like this, where they say if this kind of an organism is, you can immediately tell in the field, even a child can go and say the water quality is good or bad. And the technique has been developed to an extent that once I accompanied the people from Karlsruhe on River Rhine, and they could sample several hundred spots in half a day. They quickly go and sample and identify the organisms and list it. So this has been done very much in practical applications. For other indices, I have just used this recent publication that how the indices started developing from the Trent index, from a small river Trent in UK, where this index was developed. Then it has been elaborated. And within England, this index has come up in a big way gradually. It became known as BMWP, Bio Monitoring Working Parties Score, and so on. Now it has been replaced by, for rivers specifically, a RIVPAC system, River Invertebrate Prediction and Classification System, and is used nationally on a large scale. So they have done it. Australians have developed their own OSRIVAR system on the same type of rivers. And other countries, practically each European country has its own system. Americans are developing still under EPA their systems. I will not go into the nitty-gritties of each of them. The other group of organisms is diatom. The most beautiful organisms seen under the microscope, beautifully ornamented, long-living. They can tell you the history of the world even 50,000 years ago, because they remain, and there is no force on the earth that can destroy them. We boil them in strong sulfuric acid to identify them. You can imagine, if you can boil an organism in a strong sulfuric acid and then identify which genus or species it is, and the structure doesn't change. They have been used for identifying, and they are very, very sensitive to water quality conditions. And we have with us Professor Nautiyal, who has done a lot of work not only on the benthic invertebrate, but also on the diatoms, and is one of the few specialists in this country. So I won't go into the diatom-based indices, but in Europe, each country has developed its own index and key to every that. That much thing is there. Fish-based monitoring. This is again very much advanced, though it was started in 1981 by Carr as an index of biotic integrity. But now the fish-based indices, again, because the fish communities respond significantly and predictably to almost all kinds of anthropogenic disturbances, including eutrophication, acidification, chemical pollution, flow regulation, physical habitat alteration, fragmentation, human exploitation, and even the introduced species. So you name the pressure, and the fish community can tell what is happening. So they can be used. We have not used them still that widely, but there are. And various parameters and so on, which were used in developing. Plants have a problem, because the emergent macrophyta, which are rooted in the mud, they take nutrients and they are influenced by the soil conditions and not just by the water conditions. Those which are free floating on the surface, they are again affected by the water quality, but they can move away and from one place to another may escape some conditions. But those which are growing submerged under water, of course always in shallow waters, are fairly good indicators. We started something on this, but there are, in Europe, the EU's Water Framework Directive has issued last year specific instructions for the use of macrophytes for their river monitoring. I listed and I have mentioned a few of them. I mentioned specifically here a detailed exercise done on biomonitoring by CPCB. I think if I remember the year, it must be 89-90 with the GTZ support. And they went down sampling River Yamuna from Tajewala to the confluence, specifically up to Itawa, where Chambal also meets. And then they used five different indices, including physiological indices, photosynthesis, respiration index, and so on, BOD, everything else, and the biotic indices. And the conclusion, a meeting that, again, I was present, that none of these indices gives us the correct picture. So the whole thing was abundant. We never tried to improve upon that. After that exercise, nothing happened. There has been similar exercise a little bit. Here it was done with the benthic macroinvertebrate, but in River Kaveri, there is still a professor, some of the people here would know, K.G. Shivaram Krishnan, who is a good insect ecologist with benthic invertebrate. He sampled the entire River Kaveri, and with the help of Professor Rash in U.S., again used and compared several biotic indices that were developed in Europe and U.S. And the conclusion remained the same, that none of these indices help us identify or predict rightly the state of the River Kaveri in India. That is something very strange, that none of them can give. You know, some may be a little better perception-wise otherwise. No. So there has not been. And he has been working still now on the Western Ghats, on the insect communities and the impact of the mining influence. So the catchment characteristics have not been taken into consideration yet. That's one major area, and the riparian vegetation and the floodplains have not been assessed again. The catchment is so important. I will just purposefully brought only a few pictures. This is the catchment of River Yamuna. The kind of degradation is this, and the human pressure is this. And when I said to the Ministry of Environment, they agreed to fund a project. We did a study and gave a management plan. But somehow the state government did not agree for its implementation, citing inability to contribute their share. This is all on the ministry's official records. So this is the state. The state of peninsular rivers, a very interesting thing which comes closer to what is being attempted here, is done by Smethin and others. WWF scientists were involved, some people from different universities in South India were involved as well. And they have done this ecological status of peninsular river based on various aquatic fauna, including pristine areas, different kind of natural vegetation in the watershed and the pristine areas, as well as the floodplain or the exotics. But here there is one thing, which is the human population density in the basin as percent of that in the main floodplain. That means if there is more population in the basin and a smaller amount is in the floodplain, think it is okay. But the influences from the basin have many other pathways to reach the river. It is not necessary that the human population density should be high in the floodplain itself to have an impact. That is something it needs to be. I will be very brief on the kind of treatment. And I have given my logic here, my thought. Treatment, we have been talking of restoration. The Ministry of Environment, which had been responsible for, since Ganga Action Plan, for the restoration of the rivers, the River Conservation Plan, in 2001, in the working group discussions during the 10th plan, there was a proposal, sir, for 18,000 crores to treat municipal solid wastes for the conservation of rivers. And I told the secretary, is this the urban development minister? Is this conservation? Does conservation mean that we should go to the municipality and collect their waste and treat it there? Or that waste will come to the river and then we will treat it? It is not. At that time, in 2001, I had proposed 5 elements. There were 10 or 12. There was a workshop where the ministry had signed the resolution, ministry officials, and said this will be implemented. This is documented in the Planning Commission's document also, that they will take up these 5 top priority things. None was taken up till date. And sir, RRZ happens to be one which somehow I have the privilege of going to every meeting for 15, 16 years, but nothing has moved till date. So the floodplains are being encroached. Floodplain values are known. Groundwater recharge is not taking place. Groundwater tables have gone down, but floodplains will continue to be eliminated, not just destroyed or encroached. And that is the kind of situation which cannot save the rivers at all. We wanted all the riparian vegetation to be restored, the floodplains to be restored, the catchments to be treated, the top priority, so that the erosion doesn't affect, but somehow one or the other organ of the government. This is not the priority. Somehow they have given some money to 5 states of the Ganga Basin for riparian plantation through the Forest Department. I have learned about something, I was a part of the discussion, but I doubt if that kind of afforestation on the floodplains is going to have any effect on the rivers. So what I say is that after over the past 50 or 100 years, we have restricted the free movement of our rivers. We have forced them to flow within the confines of the embankments. We have amputated and eliminated the floodplains. We have regularly sucking their blood, both from the surface water and the groundwater. Blood is the main thing there in the river. We are regularly extracting the flesh, cutting down all the sand and gravel on which the water flows and the organisms survive, and continued transfusion of the toxics. All kinds of wastes, industrial waste, still continue to flow into the river. When this condition prevails, can we think of treatment? This happened one day in Lake Kolur, and the fishery department officials, all big Sandy from the ICR were there, and the corporates, the big companies which were using Lake Kolaru, they said, our fish are diseased. The production is going down. We add more and more organic matter, more feed into the lake, but the fish is not responding. You give me a solution, what should you do? When you dredge out the whole lake, it needs a surgery. If you have a heart disease, you have a blood pressure, go for surgery or stop eating something. But he said, no, that is not possible. If that is not possible, then the only inevitable thing will be the death. And that death came to Lake Kolaru of that town through the Supreme Court's orders. So I say, what kind of treatment can be prescribed to improve the health of the river unless the condition itself is checked? For 40 years, we have been simply cleaning the rivers. Conservation was in namesake.